All right, I guess we're going to get started. Might have some other people circling in, but it seems to be majority of the people that are coming are probably here. So for those of you that don't know me, my name is Tony Schultz. I'm the chair of Boston ADS. Thanks for coming. We've got some interesting things to hear about, some products here. I came across, actually, a newspaper article in, I guess it was Mass High Tech or something, that was talking about some products that this company was putting together. It's a guitar player again. Clipped it out and put it aside, and was kind of looking at it a couple times. And then when I was thinking about some guest speakers to feature for our, one of our meetings, I was looking at that and I ended up calling Bob and emailing him and seeing if he'd be interested in speaking to us. So I'm glad that he's come to talk to us today about some of the products that he's been working on, and maybe he'll tell us a little bit about some of the past things he's been working on previous to getting with Source Audio. So I'd like to introduce Bob Shedwell.
Campus since about 1970 when I saw the Jefferson airplane here. I don't think my performance tonight is really going to compare to that, but I'll do what I can. This was also my very first PowerPoint presentation, so be kind. Back when I started my career, we used naturally occurring pigments that we applied by hand on the cave walls. And I guess this is progress. If you want to ask questions during the presentation, feel free. You know, it's a good question, and not a nitpicking question. Source Audio is a privately funded startup. Two of our guys, there's only four of us, but two of the guys were working in analog devices, and I was consulting at analog devices. And they decided they really wanted to have their own company. Then it would be fun. And I guess it has been fun. And with the technology that they were familiar with at analog devices, such as inexpensive DSP chips and accelerometer chips, we launched our product line. So Guitar FX pedals have been steadily growing. I think when I saw the airplane in 1970, there probably wasn't anything more than a wah pedal on stage, is my guess. Although I wasn't perhaps quite as focused on pedals back then. But now we get things like this pedal board here. This strikes me as a bit over the top. But evidently, Kevin Shields likes it. This reminds me of nothing more than a modular synthesizer, where you have the huge patch panels, a million knobs and wires. And it's really sort of along the same spirit. Of course, meanwhile, 99% of your synthesizer players have migrated to all digital platforms. If you want to play a keyboard polyphonically, it's just not at all practical to start patching, have elaborate patching and a module for every note you want to play at the same time. Of course, guitars are polyphonic too, but there we sum all the signals down to a single wire, and again, this kind of thing becomes feasible. Well, there's all kinds of companies making effects pedals now, from really huge companies like Roland's Boss Line and Line 6. And then there's garage operations and even what you might call kitchen table operations, where somebody builds two pedals a week or something, if he feels like it. And he's got a waiting list of 2 years. Some people are into it enough to do that. We're somewhere between huge and garage. That we have a real space, but it's not a really huge space. A lot of companies that make these sort of boutique guitar pedals are really trying to create sounds from the past. And in my mind, there's entirely too much emphasis So, in fact, we'll see on some of the pedals we've got here, we in fact have some models of old sounds. But as I always tried to do in the synthesizer work that I did for Kurzweil Music, it's like, okay, give them some old, classic old sounds. Yeah, you got your strings, you got the electric piano, but you can mangle those sounds into something truly weird and strange. So I'm trying to apply the same philosophy here. Some classic sounds, but some stuff that is also exceedingly non-classic. So then we've got people making things like this, the Line 6, one of their pods. It emulates a guitar amplifier and a whole bunch of different effects, of which many of them can be run simultaneously. And there's a display and you can edit it. But curiously enough, the really big names of guitar players tend not to use this stuff. You know, these things have a certain sound. It's like, yes, you can have a variety of various effects, but if it isn't really the best sound you can find, why use it? Nonetheless, this kind of stuff is sounding better all the time as people learn how to do things. And where the future is going to be in effects, whether it's built into a guitar, which might seem wasteful to build an effect system into every guitar you own, because nobody just owns one guitar anymore unless you can't afford it. But you know, again, the cost of digital processing is falling and falling and falling. So to build all the effects into the guitar, it's quite feasible. You can have discrete floor units where you patch together all these things to do one thing, or you can have these multi-effects units. They could also end up migrating into amplifiers. Or they could, of course, migrate into PCs, where your back line is no longer a wall of Marshall stacks, but it's the back line of PCs opened up, with their screens glowing brightly in the dimly lit stage. And in fact, all these things are occurring now. Where the future will be, I don't know. We just have to try to stay ahead of it. I guess I'll predict things will be becoming more and more digital as people figure out how to make digital sense of it. Okay, that's my summary of the marketplace. So the first idea that we had was to use an accelerometer as a controller. And that wasn't my idea, it was the other engineer, Jesse Remignani. I have to give him credit for that. And I heard this idea and I just said immediately, yeah, I like that. I see how this could be really powerful. Unfortunately, the rest of the world hasn't really quite figured it out yet. It's a hard thing to communicate with just words on a page. You really sort of have to see it. And it's not even the most convenient thing to demo in a store because you've got to put the accelerometer ring on, and then you've got to make sure the ring doesn't just sort of walk out of the store. Not that it would do anyone any good to have just the ring, but the internet is actually helping this because it's easy to go to our website and watch video demos, provided we can get them to the website. Before I go any further, I want to just show basically what it is we're talking about. As opposed to rambling on in a more abstract way. This ring has an accelerometer and an RF transmitter. And hopefully everything is set up now. It lends itself to big gestures. if you're into that sort of thing. Or you can just play very, without the big gestures. Alright, so before I go any further on that, that was just to sort of show you what it is this does. So, many years ago in the Journal of Experimental Musical Instruments, I read this article that talked about what if a violin had never been invented? And now somebody suddenly comes up with the idea, oh, let's make a violin. Okay. And he hands it to you. And you try it out. And what do you get? Scraping noises. Out of tune scraping noises. Because you've never played a violin. You don't know what a violin is. And it's really tough to play. But you don't know what the violin is capable of because you haven't heard music all your life with violins in it. So you don't really know, is it worth actually learning how to play this thing? And it's quite conceivable it might not catch on. And no one might really bother to learn what you can do with a violin. And I wouldn't claim that this accelerometer controller is as great as a violin. But I think it is a similar thing. People have to want to learn to spend a little bit of time. It's nothing like the time it takes to play a violin, I assure you. 15 minutes, you're there. But you still have to want to at least try it out. And we're working. So here's an accelerometer. It's called a micro machine. It's made out of silicon crystal, just the same way your typical digital processing chips are. And the silicon has been cut, chemically machined to such a small size that the silicon crystal will actually flex just under gravity. And you can measure that amount of flexing capacitively, very much like a condenser microphone. And in fact, you can use accelerometers as microphones. I've actually heard something that sounds vaguely like speech, just putting the output of this into a high gain amp. And there's an article in the latest Acoustics Today, put out by the Acoustical Society, that talks about accelerometers as microphones. So when we first started looking into this, we said, well, look, this thing is putting out acceleration. If we integrate acceleration twice, we get position. So maybe we can tell where the player is on stage relative to where he was when he turned it on. But the people at the Analog Devices Accelerometer Division told us very quickly, no, that doesn't work at all. You know, within a second, you'll be off by several meters and rapidly growing beyond that. So you can't really use it as an inertial guidance system to run your cruise missile or anything like that. But it's quite accurate enough for us. Airbag technology, which is driving all this stuff. That's perhaps a poor choice of words. Airbag technology is driving it. But again, these things are really dirt cheap. This is a two-axis accelerometer, which is what we're using. So it's measuring the acceleration in two perpendicular directions. Using both axes turns out to be sort of difficult, especially if you're trying to play guitar. You just can't put your hand in an arbitrary position. So mostly what we've done is just to allow them to pick one of the two directions, or even with a little bit of trigonometry, you can project, pick another direction that's in the plane of the two measured directions, and you can project out what is the acceleration along that axis. We've had people use this on guitar, bass, pedal steel, keyboards, vocals, and even violin. Somebody came in and tried it out on the violin, and I thought it was pretty good. I don't think he's ended up buying one, but hopefully there's someone out there using it on the violin. So we're using a range of plus or minus 1.6 g's, where g is the acceleration from gravity. So what we measure as you tilt the accelerometer, you can go from, say, minus 1 g to plus 1 g. And if you actually are moving your hand, it's very easy to get an acceleration that is really huge. You know, to hit 5 g's with your hand, that's easy. But in fact, it's not really very interesting to measure those extremes. So we've settled for a range of about plus or minus 1.6, and that seems to be sort of fine. Now, there is this concept of gravity is an acceleration, and so is motion. And in fact, the general relativity tells us that if you're in a sealed box and you've got all the physics equipment you want, you can't figure out if that sealed box is on the surface of a planet pulling you down with gravity, or you're in outer space with a rocket accelerating you. You can't really tell the difference between gravity from mass or gravity from motion, from acceleration of motion. So you get both. If you're moving the accelerometer like this, you'll get one range. And if it's the same motion but now tilted, now you've got gravity added to this. But rather than really trying to explain all that, which admittedly is sort of a complicated concept, general relativity not being the simplest thing, especially for your basic position. Again, what you really do is you just put the ring on and you play with it a while, and it really becomes pretty clear what happens. So, you know, and knowing anything about physics, it doesn't really help you. You just have to get used to it. But I couldn't resist throwing in a little general relativity. Now, since when you're playing guitar, your hand is typically sort of in this position. You might well want to make the zero of the sensor occur at that position rather than a flat position. So there's a way of calibrating the zero position. You hold it however you want, and you hit the calibrate button, and it will calibrate to that being the zero position. Now, another thing we've got to do is we've got to smooth the response of the accelerometer, or it's just too jittery.
I'll demonstrate that.
With a medium sort of response. Do we need a little more volume on this? Can we hear this, or do we need just a hair? Well, and at the slowest speed, the slowest response, the most filtering on the accelerometer. speed, the acceleration on your hand from picking a string that sounds like some sort of envelope being triggered, but it's not. It's really the acceleration. So depending on whether or not you want that kind of pick attack, translates back to analog before it goes into the box. And that's left over because, of course, we want it to be able to use the same, to plug the wireless part into the boxes that were set up for the wired ring. The wired ring, of course, sent out analog. So, it's not really so much an accuracy issue or a latency issue, but it means that we can't really put other buttons on the ring which would allow you to switch the effect on and off remotely. I mean, you can wander all over the stage controlling the effect, but if you want to switch the effect on or off, you've got to get back to the effect. Someday, maybe there'll be a future generation where the link is entirely digital, and we'll be able to put a number of little buttons on it that change the state on or off, and maybe changes presets, whatever. But unfortunately, we don't have it. Okay. So the next, so we're talking about our DSP chip. Again, we do everything digitally. There's a minimum number of op amps to buffer the signal, but we're really not interested in building analog products. This is, of course, it's also an analog devices part. I think we get a good price for analog. But in fact, these things just aren't very expensive. Which means, of course, that there's competition. We're not the only people doing this. So we have 48 million multiplied accumulates per second with this chip. It's from Analog Devices Sigma DSP line. Now, there's no instruction branching in this chip. It just executes its 1,000 instructions, one right after the other, and it can't do what most CPUs do, which is to say, test something, and if this is true, execute this portion of code. If it's false, execute this other portion of code. That's far too sophisticated for this little chip. Instead, with a condition, you can use that condition to load a register or not to load a register. So that doesn't sound like much, but it's just enough. It's just enough to get by. This gives some sort of idea what's on this chip. It has 1,000 instructions, 1,000 data words, and 1,000 multiplier coefficient words. I think all this data are like 28 bits long. So it does 28 bit arithmetic, fixed point, and very easy support for double precision. And in fact, it's so easy that we do almost all the audio processing in double precision just so we can say, you know, it's a 56-bit part because it sounds good. And occasionally you actually need it. But you just don't really have to worry. Now, of course, a typical PC has perhaps 100,000 times the memory and 50 times the clock speed, which just seems like an absurd comparison. But this chip is not running Windows. Yeah, when the chip wakes up, it just starts executing its instructions, and that's all it ever does. Now, another microcontroller chip could be writing coefficients into it and controlling it that way. But again, it just really doesn't have to do much other than its own little task. And 1,000 instructions is a lot. And we also don't get the block processing that you typically do on a PC. On a PC, on a digital audio workstation, you know, you're processing many, many streams of data. And the overhead involved in switching from the processing of one stream to the processing of another stream is large enough that you've got to actually process a block of samples. But we just do, one sample comes in, 48,000 times a second at our sampling rate. One sample comes in, and one sample goes out. So there's no block processing, there's no latency due to that kind of block processing, which I think is a great leap forward. Having been annoyed at the latency of digital audio workstations for many, many years, and I'm still not impressed. So we've got stereo audio converters built into this chip. We've also got four channels of ADD conversion to scan potentiometers and other sorts of switches and the like. Back in 1983, when I was working at Kurzweil Music Systems, we bought a 16-bit monophonic digital audio I/O system for $25,000. And I dare say this outperforms it. So, again, technology marches on. Now, digital audio effects pedals, a lot of people tend to sort of sneer at them and say, oh, yeah, it just sounds digital. And frequently, I have to agree, yeah, they do sound digital and not really very good. Because people don't really understand how to write good algorithms. They don't understand how to lay out PC boards without garbage leaking in, digital garbage leaking into the audio signal. So I'm not saying it's easy to do good sounding digital stuff, but it certainly is possible. Some of our endorsing artists have said that our product is the first digital pedal they've actually used. So that was a nice vote of confidence. Right. So the first products we came out with were the big ones on the left there. And they were sort of pricey. And they originally came out with a wired accelerometer. And at the time we started the company, I'm afraid I have to admit, I was just plugging my guitar directly into a tube amp and turning it up until it sounded good. And I really wasn't using effects. So I've mended my ways now. And now I understand why you want the boxes to be on the small side. Because if you've got a dozen large boxes, you're putting them on a really large pedal board and it gets heavy. And unless you've got the roadies to move your pedal board, which most of the marketplace doesn't, then you really want to keep things small. Our new line are smaller. They're still bigger than a lot of other companies, I must admit. Okay, so let's look at... this is one from our new line of sound blocks. A wah pedal, which is what we've been listening to. So we ripped out the microcontroller chip. We made it smaller. We made it out of plastic instead of metal. So the fact that the microcontroller isn't there means the DSP chip has to actually scan these knobs and the encoder and the switch. It's just horrible to make a DSP chip actually have to deal with things like switches. I am sorry about that. But we had to. And the other thing we threw in was it's got a low frequency oscillator that does a slow periodic sweep of the effect. It's also got an envelope follower, which is looking at the instantaneous level of the audio signal coming in and using that as a control. And you can also plug in the hot hand receiver and use it with the ring. Which is, we call this the hot hand. I think I forgot to say that. But that's more marketing speak. I had nothing to do with any of these names, I assure you. I just write the code. So anyway, that's where TriMod came from. You can do the automatic LFO sweep, you can envelope follower, you can plug in the hot hand receiver. So we can get people to buy this thing without having to also fork over more money for the ring and the receiver. And in fact, while they last, we've been shipping wired rings with these boxes, hopefully enticing people to go out and buy the wireless. But we obviously have a large quantity of wired rings that are not moving, so just trying to get them out there. Okay, our first box was a wah, and this is also a wah here. A wah, of course, is usually controlled with a foot pedal. So that was an effect that seemed, a good choice for our first product. Because you're used to directly controlling the position of the filter, which which is what the WAW is. It's just a moving filter. Now, if this doesn't really replace a wah-wah pedal that you're using your foot to control, because even though it can do the same sort of sound, with a foot controller, you can slowly move this down and up over several seconds. With the hand controller, of course, you constantly got to be playing the guitar. So you can't really do the same thing. But nonetheless, it is useful. So there's a whole bunch of effects around that encoder. I'm not sure how legible that is. The very first one is called Classic Wah, which is an implementation of this analog circuit. This dates from like 1966 with the Crybaby Wah pedal. And with a little bit of work, especially from a symbolic math program, because there's no way I could have done this without the symbolic math. It's just, I make too many mistakes. But you can reduce this to a digital filter, which is controlled by the potentiometer over on the middle right-hand side. Now, of course, I'm not really going to write those equations up here, because that was a lot of work. But I just will say, yes, you can do this. And it amazingly sounds very much like the Crybaby Wah pedal, which is not a classic low-pass or band-pass filter. It's really something a little bit more complicated. Now, we're not trying to model non-linearities of the transistors. And we're also not modeling the potential bizarreness of the inductor. That was just beyond the scope of this project. Modeling nonlinearities is a difficult thing. And check back in a couple of years. Sometimes you do find sort of classic resonant low-pass and band-pass filters on some cheaper implementations of wah pedals. And so we threw them in too, because it's another sound that's useful. And this is the circuit, the digital circuit that we're using to accomplish those filters. Hal Chamberlain is the first person who published this that I know of. And this is what a digital audio filter really looks like in terms of the processing. We've got additions, we've got multiplications, we've got filter coefficients, and we've got these things labeled, boxes labeled Z, which is a delay of a single sample. So a sample goes in, and then the next time around the same sample comes out of that box. So there's only three delays, three multiplications, and we get low pass and band pass filter outputs from this. You can adjust the Q very simply by just plugging Q in as 1 over Q on that one multiplier. The coefficient A is given by the formula up there, and that's also just really very simply done with a simple lookup into a sine table. It's just the frequency of the filter divided by the sampling rate times pi, take the sine of that, multiply by 2, and you got it. And of course, there's peculiarities of this structure. They all have their own little peculiarities. This one doesn't work well at extremely low resonance, but that's not very interesting to us. So again, having programmed this, it's then really simple to do multiple versions of that same circuit. And now we can get several bandpass outputs from these things at different frequencies. And that's what the last six effects are, labeled multi-peaks. And then we've got several peaks and possibly dips in the frequency response. And they're moving, sometimes they move together, sometimes they move in opposite directions. Some frequencies are out of phase, and they'll cancel. So you get these series of notches in the frequency response. And if the time delay is then changing, then the notches are moving. And you hear that with jet planes flying overhead. You hear the direct sound and you hear a reflected sound. Back in the days when people actually listened to sound on loudspeakers and they had 12-inch records, it was very easy to hear this by positioning the record sort of in the line of the speaker sound and sort of tilting it, and you really hear a very flangey sort of thing. Of course, I don't think this works with CD cases and ear pods, but it actually is a real effect. I mean, when we're used to it. So it's not a totally unfamiliar sound. We're used to that sound. So these were initially implemented with analog delay lines, where an analog signal was sampled in these bucket brigade chips. So it was sampled but not digitized. And then there's a variable, a voltage-controlled clocking these samples along the delay line. And the voltage-controlled clock is being driven by a low-frequency oscillator. So you'd be speeding up and slowing down, changing the time delay. So, but we can't really use a variable clock. We have our fixed 48 kilohertz clock. And instead, we've got a delay line, which is just an area of memory that samples are written into as they come into the box. And they move on down the line. And that addressing is actually all done automatically by the DSP chip without having to do anything special of calculating addresses. It's all very convenient. Except it also happens for things that you don't want to put into delay lines. So if you put something in one location, it's not going to be there the next time around. So you do have to watch that. But the delay lines, so that's easy. So we just have certain addresses in the RAM, and we read out the value that's there. Now, if you just grab the closest value as you're trying to move periodically back and forth, if you just grab the closest number, you would do very much what the Ensoniq Mirage sample playback synthesizer did back many decades ago, and it sounded quite horrible. Although they probably made a lot of money on it. But it sounded horrible to me. Taking the closest sample really doesn't do things justice. Instead, you have to do some sort of interpolation so it smoothly changes. For instance, the point you want is really 30% of the way between two samples that you know. You can add 30% of one value and 70% of the one on the other side. And that gives you a smooth value that's in between. That's called linear interpolation. But linear interpolation is actually not very good either. And again, there's so much horsepower in this chip, why not do a really, really good job? So we do a really, really good job. It's a very high order interpolation. There's a lot of literature on this. It's called multi-rate signal processing. We do a much better job than in the Kurzweil products that I shipped. And I wish we could go back and redo those now, but it's too late. And again, we've got enough horsepower that why stop with a single tap? We can do multiple taps. Even though it's not really technically a flanger anymore, it still has some of that characteristic to it. So I think it sounds really interesting. Although a lot of people have sort of tuned out flangers. It's like, oh yeah, I heard a flanger back in the 80s, yeah, and I got tired of it. Because it was just whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. Just the same whoosh back and forth periodically. And okay, I can see you get tired of that. These sounds are much more interesting. Of course, we're still calling the box the flanger. So how do we really how do we really get the word out? I don't know. That's marketing. I don't know. Marketing. Although, I suppose this might be supermarket. Let's see. What else we do? We can have feedback. We can feed some of the delay signal back into the delay line, which causes peaks in the frequency response in addition to the notches that you would get. And it can make the effect sound a little bit more intense, or it can make the effect sound very, very metallic. Now, alas, the decision was made, 3 adjustable knobs on these products. I've always pushed for more knobs, but they just won't let me have it. So you don't get an adjustable feedback control. Instead, the big selector switch gives you 12 different versions of flangers, and that fixes the feedback. That's something that we think is musically useful. So the last thing we do with feedback is, if you don't add any of the input signal and just take a simple delayed signal with the tap moving back and forth, you get vibrato. And it's just very much like a Doppler shift. It's much more interesting if there's a little bit of feedback when you're in the vibrato setting. If there's no feedback, then the whole vibrato is so mechanical. Yes, the entire frequency spectrum moves up together and moves down together, and it's just totally perfect. But on a real instrument, lots of other things happen while you're doing vibrato. And so a little bit of feedback for the vibrato setting puts these low frequency response bumps in, and they move around too, and it's much, much more organic.
Okay, let's listen to a few of these now.
Now here I've got the flanger patched after the distortion. The distortion adds all these high frequencies. And it's better, my way of thinking, it's better to have these high frequencies occur in front of the flanger so that the flanger can drop its notches on these high frequencies. And it's just, it makes the flanger sound so much stronger. If you reverse the order, then all those notches that the flanger was busy creating tend to be swallowed up by all the distortion. And so it still makes a difference to the sound, and it still might be interesting, but it's not maybe sounding as classical flangery as you'd like, or as I'd like. And hey, I get to make the decision. Okay. So, with a simple LFO. I must say, my toughest engineering music gig was at Analog Devices, where I had to demonstrate a vocal chorus to a conference room full of engineers and marketing people in the middle of the day, just without even any accompaniment. And not only had the audience not been drinking heavily, no, I don't really think they had been drinking at all. So that was my toughest engineering music gig. All right, what have we done?
Bob, when you're switching the knobs, I can hear the sounds.
I thought I did maybe hear a click there.
Is there, is there a bypass on there? Like, sometimes I'm not a true bypass.
Yeah, this is a buffered bypass. Yeah, I forgot to mention all that. You know, in terms of the cost of the switch, comes down to cost, you know. The cost of a switch to do true bypass is a lot more than this momentary contact thing, which then is digitally latched and controls some analog switches. So it's not true bypass. We think it sounds really pretty good, but pretty low noise, and it's not going through the converters. But it is going through an op amp, or possibly two. Okay. And envelope follower. Which is also not maybe the most common thing. So that's not really a conventional flanger. That's one of these multiple tap flangers. I'm not quite sure how many taps this has, but it might be like five or something. And now the hot end. One of them warned about the hit. Oh yeah, unfortunately, to switch rings, you have to actually power down the receiver and then power things up in the right order. Okay, so this is... Fortunately, at my age, I no longer care about looking silly.
Okay, so,
keeping my head stationary, the wah is controlled by my hand. And the flanger is controlled by my head. Incidentally, if you suffer from vertigo, I don't really recommend doing this. If I fall over, it's not part of the act, okay? Don't let me hit my head. So, now for something completely different. In multi-band distortion. I stole this idea from Craig Anderton, who many years ago published a do-it-yourself project in which you split the signal into four frequency bands and distort them all separately and recombine them. Of course, poor musicians steal and good musicians are influenced. So, perhaps the same applies to engineering here. Perhaps I'm influenced. Here we are now dividing the frequency into 10 bands. And they're pretty steep bands. And it's a very, can be a very different sort of sound. Right now we've been listening to the distortion doing its most normal sound. Without dividing things into multiple bands. But it's not the same as taking a separate signal for every string and distorting them separately. I mean, that's also cool, but then you need a special pickup and special processing. And here, this is just any old guitar plugged into this box, splits it into 10 bands, each about half an octave wide, and separately distorts them and adds them back up. So it reduces the intermodulation distortion tremendously. It allows you to play really complicated chords through massive distortion. Sus4s, major sevenths, ninths, things that you normally wouldn't really want to play with heavy distortion. Because it just ends up as mush. And here you can get away with this for some of the settings. But then, that wasn't enough either, so we added even more stuff. Some of the distortion curves don't look anything like a normal distortion. And in fact, we had to put a compressor in front of this. And normally, of course, you get a lot of compression out of a distortion. But some of these distortion curves are very level sensitive. And the sound changes radically. So there's a compressor in front that can reduce that level variation. So this is what the architecture is. And what about this distortion curve magnums? Sort of classically, there's a sort of linear region around very small signals. If you think of the input signal along the x-axis and the output signal along the y-axis. And as the signal gets bigger, it starts to bend over and starts to flatten out.
And you have to sort of imagine if you keep turning up the distortion drive here, that the input signal gets very big, but the output stays fixed at 1. So the curve just flattens out and goes on forever. This is not precisely the distortion curve we're using. That's just the sine wave. And that's not what we're using. And I'm afraid I'm not going to show you exactly what it is we're using, but I'm not entirely sure it makes much difference. But now we've got things called fallback, where the input signal rises, the output rises, but then instead of just pinning at full scale positive or negative, it actually starts to drop. And it goes all the way, graph down to full scale negative. So put a sine wave in and turn up the distortion drive, and it starts to flatten out. But then on the positive going side, the top starts to bend over, fold back over. And for this curve, if you then continued to turn up the distortion drive, it would eventually saturate at minus full scale. And there's no reason we can't actually have more foldings on both sides of zero. And in fact, the selector control gives you a whole variety of these various folding curves. And it really screws up the signal sometimes here. So this is a very, very non-traditional sampling. And I like that idea that you do something so hideous to the signal. Of course, you could have bought a Kurzweil effects processor many years ago and done the same thing. But I recycle my ideas. I'm not going to show any curves for octave processing, but in fact the last series of multiband things are called octave. There's a very, very strong octave component, and if you really turn up the signal a lot for the octave, it just screws things up even more than the full band. And then there are the same sorts of things of sort of normal distortion, fallback, and octave, done with just a single band of processing. So, what does this sound like? Normally on a distortion, if the level is up you know, one of the strings will really sort of take over, and you'll just hear that string feedback. But the nature of this, the way the processing is done, you can get multiple strings feeding back. And that's something you absolutely can't do with a normal distortion.
But I'll spare you that, perhaps.
Yeah. All right, let's see, a fallback. Keep in mind, we're not trying to sound like Eric Clapton. Send out both accelerometer axes as MIDI continuous controls. You can also program triggered ramps, where if as the controller goes past a certain position, it can trigger a ramp on, and then go back down again. When you pass the trigger point again, times of these rams are adjustable. And you can pick just where, what MIDI channel and what controller numbers you're sending on. It also has a single output to plug into a box that's looking for an expression pedal. You can plug in there, provides either a voltage output or a resistance output, an emulated resistance output. Because we've found some boxes, instead of expecting a continual voltage, they're expecting to digitally scan a potentiometer. And so giving it a voltage, it's very unhappy with. But this can deal with that kind of interface too. So we're hoping this will get another section of the market together. Find something that we can do for them. So check out our website if you're interested. There's a lot more videos on there. That's about it. Are there any questions? After we're done with questions, if you want to come out and try this, try it. Feel free. I'll hang around for quite some time.
Can you make the two notes move back?
Pardon? All right. Sort themselves out. You have to be careful, though, in powering them up one at a time. If somebody throws the big switch and all the equipment comes on at once, then you've got four receiving and you've got four of them, say. And they're all looking for a ring. You turn one ring on, it doesn't really tend to work right. You've got to sort of power them on one at a time. But we figured four seemed like a good number. If anyone really wants to do more than four, it's probably excessive.
Have you got any performance artists to do things like with one ring on each hand and one on each foot or anything like that?
Well, you probably saw my YouTube video. YouTube video, which I think it's called Bob Plays the Hot Hands, which I haven't found a link to it on our website. It has me with a ring on either hand and plugged into a modular, big modular synthesizer. So I'm controlling four parameters. And it's all very goofy looking. What we've got in terms of people, there's this artist called Kid Beyond who does vocal stuff. It's just sort of, and he loops his own vocal noises, sounds, whatever. And he's using our MIDI box now. He said he didn't have anything to do with his hands, and he was always waving them around anyway. So he said, well, he might as well, you know, actually control the sound. We started in, I think it was January of 05. And our very first time we got together, I had a lashed up prototype that we could try out. But to go from just something that's a proof of concept to shipping product, that's a long time to get the bugs out. Find someone to build this in China, I regret to say. I mean, it's been all right, but I just feel guilty still. But soon our wages will be lower than the Chinese, and then we can start. But don't get me going on that.
So I noticed you didn't use the controller with the distortion pedal. You didn't use the hot hands.
Oh, yeah. I mean, obviously, it's again built on exactly the same platform, so there is a hot hand input to this. And the hot hand input will allow you to ramp up the distortion drive by, I think it's 20 or 26 decibels. So you can sustain a note here and then move your hand up and we'll really take off. I didn't really demo that, but I'm not sure any of our fans of the multi-wave distortion, we do have a number of fans. I don't know if anyone's actually using it that way. But it's just one more thing. I mean, there's possibilities, and people just have to play with these and discover everything they can do. Someone tried it out at the NAMM show when we still had wired rings. And having a wire trailing from the bow was not good.
I remember when we were talking about the flanger, and there was a mode, it might have been on the larger model, there was a mode where you could control the pitch directly up to a certain point. Do you remember what I'm talking about? Like you could do I guess it was like an act. Well, maybe you were mentioning it. You could do a vibrato. Not that you were actually, not that you were flanging, but you were turning down one of the direct signals and getting just the pitch modulated signal.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking that would be real cool for a keyboard player, because the times that I've used it with a keyboard, I found
direct.
Yeah,
if you're just using your hand.
Just like on a guitar, you know, you can do this on the guitar, you can vibrato, you can do this on the key, and, you know.
It's easier also than using a ribbon controller.
Yeah.
You don't have to, like, the friction of the ribbon controller is not there just on your hand.
Right, and it's the same, and it's the same hand that you're, the same fingers that you're playing the solo with, just like on a guitar. So has that been something that you've kind of tried to promote at all? Or? Keyboard players and stuff. I thought it was great on keyboards myself.
I'm not even sure we had an ad in a keyboard oriented magazine. So I'm not sure we're really promoting it. I didn't even bother to demo the vibrato, but it is, yeah, it is nice. I mean, again, it does a lot of stuff. I mean, a lot of these boxes, you know, somebody has like. Every pedal is really there to do one specific thing. They set up the knobs to do one sound, and then they turn it on and turn it off if it's on off control. And it does one thing for them. And these boxes, of course, they can do a lot more stuff, which is why perhaps it's a shame we don't have presets on these. But you know, you saw how much time it took me to fiddle with them. It would. Well, I mean, that's not getting too critical of our stuff.
You just gotta buy more boxes.
Buy more boxes, hey, that works.
You can throw more than one box with a single ring.
You know, the larger boxes, you could actually daisy chain them together. But these don't have that extra sensor output. One could conceivably, you know, build some special purpose hardware. It doesn't really take much. This just needs, I think it's 3.3 volts at 100 milliamps. And then you get two analog signals out. And you could then put that into a buffer, fan it out to all your boxes. It's not a really big engineering project. But that doesn't really, the sales to people who want to do their own custom work like that is insignificant. So I wouldn't expect to sell too many people who want to do that. Yeah, it is a shame you can't really just have a single ring that you could then switch on another control on the box that would say, all right, now the ring is controlling this box. Like I said, the older, larger, more expensive boxes.
You still sell?
Yeah, we still sell them. Boy, we got piles of them.
What did you say the distance is? The maximum distance between the ring and the receiver is?
I think we were claiming 100 yards on the.
That's that.
Or was it 100 feet?
I think it said 30 meters on the.
30 meters?
On the thing, so maybe it was 100 feet.
Maybe it was 100 feet. It's supposed to slowly drop back to the zero position, which seemed like the best thing you could do if you lose the signal, as opposed to peg it at one extreme or the other, because that's most likely to produce a sound out of the pedal, which is not what you really want it to be sitting at. I think I can say that we've shipped 1,000 pedals now, and we just recently crossed that threshold. It still isn't enough to pay the bills, but we're getting there. Coming out soon is a multi-wave distortion optimized for bass. It's really been quite totally revamped. And I think a chorus pedal at some point in the future. I think it's safe enough to say that. I mean, it's not going to subtract sales of our other pedals. So I think it's safe to say, yes, a pedal of a type we haven't
we haven't built yet. We'll be coming out with one.
Who do you think is Euro's high profile artist?
The high profile artist. Yeah, that's the name of the game in the musical instrument business is getting famous people to use your products on stage and talk about it in the interviews. We haven't got anyone ridiculously famous. My morning jacket uses it. They're really quite nice if you have to check them out. The band Mo is also a fan of ours. We got one to the Edge's guitar tech, who showed it to the Edge, and it didn't grab him. We got a prototype bass distortion to Bootsy Collins, and it didn't grab him. But Victor Wooten likes it. One of our most effective marketing things was to rent a backstage area at some of the big rock shows, you know, like 2-day rock shows. For a few $1,000s, you can get backstage with a little booth where the artists are. And that was an excellent idea because they're hanging out and, you know, eventually you can't take any more drugs. You got to do something else. Might as well just wander around and, oh, what do these people got? So that was one of the better ideas. But like I said, super huge names. Now we have to do a snag. Other questions? Right, if anyone wants to, you know, try it out, please feel free. I went up there and played. Well,